morning. Let's see if this will not come flying out again. Kind of scared now to adjust it. Literally, almost every week it goes, literally, I'm not joking. Go back, watch on Facebook, you'll see. We've had to exchange it out like 10 times. Can I find one that works, please? Well, if this is your first time with us, it's awesome to have you here. My name is Pastor Liberty, and we welcome you. Very happy to have you here. And so let's give a glad to have you. Welcome to those that are our guests today. We have kind of been going through a series that we've been doing, and so I'm going to kind of recap a little bit so that you could understand today's message. Now, I do recommend that you either go back on our YouTube page or on our Facebook page, go back through and watch the last couple of messages that we've done so that you can kind of understand the flow of what God's doing, because we're kind of building on it every week. And so well, we're working on getting them posted too. So it's probably better if you go to the Facebook page, because they're already there. They don't have to be edited, downloaded, and moved to YouTube, which is quite an ordeal. Who here lives in this area? Okay, who here knows the Wi-Fi is no Wi-Fi? Right? No Wi-Fi. Okay. Literally, to get stuff to download out here, it's like we need somebody who lives somewhere where there's high speed. You can turn it down just a little bit. Internet to do the downloading, because how many hours to do one video? 3 hours for a video. Yeah, all night. It's taken all night because the Wi-Fi goes in and out, and it just doesn't want to work some of the times. And so, and I know some of you post on the Rainbow page. If you're from out here, you'll post on there. Anyone else's Wi-Fi out? I don't ever post on there, but I do laugh at other people's posts. And Wi-Fi is an issue. So if it takes a little while to get them on there, that's why. Just go back to the Facebook page. That's the best place. Open it up. Go back to the Facebook page. And then just, if you want to skip ahead, to just get to the message, because on the YouTube channel, you're just getting the message. He downloads it, and he clips it out, and they do all this stuff to it. So you're just getting the sermon. And so, but if you don't want to wait, then go back. So here's what we've been talking about. We were talking about next level victory. And so over the last few weeks, some of you, if this is your first time here, sorry, you're going to have to track with me. But I believe that the message for today is going to just blow your mind. And I hope that it does, even if you're new to this faith thing and you're still not quite sure about it. I still think it'll blow your mind, this revelation that God has for you today. But we've been talking about next level victory. And to get to the next level victory, there's three things we needed to do. 1 week, we talked about walking in love. Who enjoyed that? Okay. I saw people's faces when we were preaching, and they were just like, okay. Because walking in love is not easy, right? And so sometimes we get saved, and we still act like a turkey. I say that with love. Anyone here been a turkey this morning on the way here? And then you got out of the car. And then guess what you did? Hi! Don't you dare look at me during service. More space. No, I'm just kidding. We do that, right? We don't walk in love. To have next level victory, here's what you have to understand about next level victory. And sorry, guys, I'm doing the recap, especially for those that are just coming in on this. So let's say there's a mountain we have to climb, and there's a piece of fruit dangling at the top of the mountain. That fruit is already there. It's already been growing. It's been being produced and just, you know, getting ready for you to come up on the mountain and pluck it. So the victory at the cross has already been won for you. But sometimes he requires us to climb up and get it. And that takes work. So that's what next level victory is. Sometimes we get tired. We don't want to walk in love. Number two, I'm just being real, you guys. Come on. Number two was unity. That one was even like, whoa. Every part of the body of Christ, every person in this church matters. We're supposed to be doing this together, even if you're the stinky toe. We don't get a saw and cut off the stinky toe. And if you remember, I had a hacksaw up here, and I had, I believe, Gideon and Haley up here, and I was going to, you know, hack body parts off. I like to get visual because I think it's more fun that way. And so, but the thing is we cannot hack each other off because we're stinky, or maybe one of us is the armpit. And we forgot deodorant. Okay? You might live with people who forget deodorant. Okay? But here's the thing. Is it doesn't matter what you're doing, what your role is, we're supposed to be doing this life together. This Christian life, we do it together. Whether you're the toe or the arm or the armpit. Here's the thing. We need armpits, you guys. Did you know you need an armpit? We gotta sweat. Otherwise, our bodies will overheat. And you know what happens if you overheat? You die. So we need the armpits in the body of Christ. And so here's the thing. Unity is so important. Number three. What was number three? I know you guys were listening. I got a lot of texts after number three. Intimately knowing God, fearing the Lord. And that was a little bit more of a serious message. But basically, do you fear God? Not in a fear way, like, I'm afraid. Not that kind of fear. That's demonic, okay? We're talking about a reverence and a respect where you care about what he thinks about what you do and what you don't do. So before you go and do that thing that you've always done that he wants you to break free from, you stop and go, wait a minute, is God okay with this? And you actually think about what he thinks about for your life. And you stop and you think. What God thinks does matter. And I need to walk in what he says matters. It doesn't mean you're going to be perfect, but it does mean you're going to try to think about, okay, what does God want? Is God okay with this thing that I'm doing? And if you're pretty sure the answer is no, then you don't do it. You just don't do it. And that's not easy. But I'll tell you, if you can embrace that, and those of you that were here for that message, almost every person here was kneeling on their face at the end of the service. The altars were full. People were up here kneeling. And we just had a time of everybody saying, I'm sorry, God, that I have not respected what you want for my life. And I am going to try my best to think about you before I make decisions. I'm going to fear you because it's not because I'm afraid like a chicken is afraid, but you're afraid that you know that he died for you and you care about what he wants for your life. That's the fear of the Lord, being in God's will. God's will is not always easy, is it? But if you fear God, you're going to care about his will over anything in your life. Now, today's message, before I pray, last week, so we built upon that, love, unity, and the fear of the Lord. Then last week, I preached a message called Dress for Battle. We're in a battle, we're in a war, if you didn't know it. The devil wants to steal your soul. He hates you. You're in a war. Now, it doesn't mean you need to go around being like, I know there's devils behind these bushes. Okay, here's the thing. There is. I'll just cure that for you. So I can say I'm not one of those pastors who will preach there's a demon behind every bush. I'm a pastor who's going to preach there's 100 demons behind every bush. okay? Because that is real. And so I don't say that as a scary thing. We're not supposed to be afraid of the devil. Greater is he that lives in you, that lives in the demonic world. But the thing is, we still have to be dressed for battle. And so last week we talked about love. If we're dressed with love, we're dressed with unity, and we're dressed with the fear of the Lord, then we have our armor on. I didn't talk about armor. Everyone knows armor in Ephesians. Most people know about that armor. But there's another kind of armor that we walk around in. And so last week, God told me to, and which is what we did, was my message I preached was a little shorter, and then he told me to anoint everybody's hands for war. So we did. I sat up here and I prayed for every single person and I anointed their hands for war and prepared them to do this that God's called them to do. Because even if it's as simple as just obeying and trusting him, that's war, you guys. It takes faith, right? Anyone here ever had to make a decision recently that took faith? And now you're probably going, why did I do that? I don't think this is going to work. And so this week, what I'm going to talk to you about is staying dressed for battle. So the title of my message this morning is stay dressed for battle. Staying dressed for battle. If you're taking notes, stay dressed for battle. And so it's not just about walking in love, unity, and the fear of the Lord. And I really want you guys, if you can, go back if you didn't see last week's message and at least go to the part where you saw me do the skit that we did, because we had a church member, they're not here today, but they were so inspired by the Next Level Victory that they went home and painted 3 pictures. They were inspired to paint. And so they came home and they painted, or went home and they painted a picture that was love, unity, and the fear of the Lord. And they actually remembered the vision that God gave me of the 3 charms on the bracelet that were turquoise hearts. I mean, she actually painted them. And so we kind of displayed them up here and we kind of did this whole little routine that we did up here. And so I'm going to go ahead and pray, and then we're going to get started on what it means to stay dressed for battle. This is the simplest message literally you're going to ever hear. It's going to blow your mind, though. And I pray that it really just gives you another level of trust in God today to move forward. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we just praise you and we glorify you. We thank you, Jesus, for all that you're doing and all that you're going to do. We welcome you, Holy Spirit, into this room. We welcome you, King of Glory. Come and speak to hearts and lives this morning, Lord. God, I pray that your anointing would be upon me to speak your words and your words alone. Reveal yourself to hearts today. And I pray that everyone here would leave different than they came. In your mighty name I pray. Amen. Okay, so stay dressed for battle. Basically, so we talked about being dressed for battle and your hands are anointed. Now what do you do? What do I do now? My hands are all greasy. I don't know. They were after last week. If you came and you got prayer, it was a mighty, mighty, I'll just tell you, I'll do it again sometime, but for those of you who weren't here, you missed out on some mighty, mighty awesome prayer time. It was, the glory was here, God was moving. I mean, it was, you have to go back and watch the video. It's all on video. So now what do you do? So today's main point is this. We must relax in God. We must relax in God. If you're taking notes, and you're probably thinking, that's like the simplest thing I've ever heard. What is that supposed to mean? I'm going to tell you what it means. You must relax in God. James 4:7. New King James Version. It's important that I tell you the versions because I'm going to go over several because this is so good. New King James Version says it like this. Therefore, submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. This is the simplest verse, you guys, but it sounds very hard. You know why it sounds hard? Submit. What? I don't want to submit. I'll submit to nobody. I can do everything myself. I don't need nobody telling me nothing. Right? Okay, come on. Quit lying. Who's guilty? Right? See? Okay, that's a whole other subject. That'll be pride someday. We'll preach on pride, okay? But here's the thing. This is way bigger than this. Look at the next two versions. Here's NLT. This is NLT's version, but it's the same verse, but updated. So humble yourselves before God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Now, the second one is the Message version. I love this. You guys, I don't read the Message Bible, and I don't have it at home. But I'll tell you, sometimes they just say it so good, it just cracks me up. So let God work his will in you. Yell loud no to the devil and watch him scamper. Say a quiet yes to God, and he'll be there in no time. Quit dabbling in sin. Purify your inner life. Quit playing the field. Hit bottom and cry your eyes out. The fun and games are over. Get serious, really serious. Get down on your knees before the master. It's the only way you'll get on your feet. Wow. Let that sink in. So see, the Message Bible is saying it the way that I would say it. I love it. Tell the devil no. And you're probably thinking, well, that's not so easy. It is, and I'm going to show you how. Basically, James 4 says, submit to God and the devil flees. This is a huge revelation because think about this. This is what God showed me when he gave me this message. He said, you go and tell them. They look at submitting as a negative thing. Submitting is actually relaxing in me. That's what he said. If they submit to me, they're just relaxing in me. They're choosing my way. They're choosing my will. They're relaxing in me. And so that's why the main point is we must relax in God. Who here finds it hard to relax? If you get bored easy, it can be very hard to relax, right? So then sometimes God will allow things to make you relax. Like injuries and car accidents. And he's like, just sit down for a minute, woman. Man, I don't know, husband, whatever. Sit, relax, stop it. I can attest to that. I'm walking proof. I'm walking proof. So here's the thing. The Lord told me, you need to help them understand this verse. He gave me the verse and he's like, tell them to stay dressed for battle, James 4:7. And I'm like, I know James 4:7. What's that have to do with being dressed for battle? Submit to God, the devil will flee. And he said, no, you need to help them understand. Relax in me, and the devil has no power over them. The devil has no power over you. Demons, the attacks of the enemy, everything this world wants to bring against you has no power over you if you relax in God. See, in the Bible, James uses the word submit because they didn't fear that back then. Here's the thing. When you saw Jesus alive on the earth doing miracles, and then you saw him get beaten and nailed to the cross for you. And you saw him rise from the dead. That changes you forever. Submit is not a hard word then after that, is it? You're talking about James saw this with his own eyes. Once you've seen something like that, you ain't ever the same. And the thing is we haven't necessarily, I know it sounds weird to say this, been blessed with being able to physically see it to help us to have that extra kick in the rear. to make us realize that, okay, we can do this, y'all. But the thing is they had, he had no problem using this word submit. But what he was really saying was, come on. Relax in God. Do his will. Just relax. Go with it. The demons will flee and they will have no power over you. Just relax. Just relax. Okay, who here has ever taken a cold bath? I mean, not like on, I know when you have a fever and you got to get well. I'm not talking about that. Okay. Who has taken a cold bath on purpose? Okay, we have weirdos in this section. I've decided this is weirdo section. Okay. Okay, here's the thing. Normally, we do not go take a cold bath. If you're normal. Okay? I'm going to look over here now to the normal people. Normal people do not go take a cold bath. Well, some people don't take baths. We won't go there. Because remember, we love those armpits. So, sorry. I just had to throw that out there. Here's the thing. You're not going to go take a cold bath. Except for this section. Here's the thing. What happens is, when we're trusting God, this is all about trust, you guys, relaxing in him. I just hope this blows your mind today. Submitting and doing stuff his way is so relaxing. The same way that when you approach a bathtub that's full of cold water and ice, you ain't getting in it. At least if you're in these two sections. You guys are not going to get in it. So here's the thing. God has a wonderful warm bath for you with bubbles. Well, okay, sorry, guys. I don't know what you guys want in it. Armor all. No, I'm just kidding. I don't know. What do guys want in a bath? Okay, water. What else besides water? Tell me something, men. Soap, okay? What? Showers. Okay, yeah. See, I raised all men in my house. We're an all-guy house. I was the only girl until Amy showed up. So, they take showers, okay? They're not really big on baths. Mama is big on a bath, okay? That's just how you do it. That's just how it is. We all know. Here's the thing. Nobody goes and takes a bath on purpose in ice water. Here's the thing, but some of you are going to take a cold bath because that's your form of trusting God. You don't see him as the warm bath where you can go and soak and relax and let him be your God and trust his will. You're the one that jumps in the cold bath and spazzes out. You need to be delivered from the spirit of cat. Anyone have the spirit of cat? Okay, if you like cats, I'm sorry. I'm not a cat person. Okay, you guys, that was my skit for today. Here's the thing. Play it again, Lloyd. Let's really let you guys see the effect of what it means when you just won't submit to God and you're not trusting him. This is what you act like. This is what you look like. Oh, Lord, help me.
Oh, no, I'm just kidding.
What have I gotten myself into? I'm spazzing out. Okay, here's the thing. Some of y'all need to be delivered from the spirit of cat. Sorry, we don't have cats. We have dogs. We are dog people. Okay? I don't know how to say it. I'm not a cat person. That's why I'm not a cat person. Okay? They spaz out. They spaz out. So here's the thing. A lot of you are doing that. That's your form of submitting. But the thing is, you're not getting what submitting means. Submitting isn't jumping in a cold bath, walking in the spirit of cat. Sorry, I just love saying that. It is going to a warm bath that the Lord has prepared for you with whatever it is you like in a bath. And you get in and you relax. That's submitting to God. You just relax. Let him be your God. Trust him with whatever he's telling you to do and called you to do. If it's in his will, trust him. Easy? No. Not always. Sometimes it is easy, right? There's been times you just know this is God's will and I'm at peace with this. This is amen, yes, Jesus. But then there's other times you're just like a cat freaking out, having a spaz fit. I don't know what to do. Relax and submit to God. Relax and submit to God. The devil will flee, and everything you think's coming against you won't have power over you. Will the attack stop? Not always. Nope. But it will no longer have power over you. You'll be able to go, really? That's all you got? Really? Bring it. But you have to get to that place where you're so relaxed that you know that God is your king and you can trust him. You can trust him. So now we're going to talk about Gideon. You want to stand up, Gideon? He's like, oh, no. Okay. Okay. Okay, everybody start talking about Gideon. Well, you know what I saw him do the other day? Okay. Look at that hair. I'm just kidding. I had to do it, you guys. Sorry. We are going to talk about Gideon because here's what's going to happen today. I believe the Lord is saying to you, will you be a Gideon? Gideon started out with the spirit of cat, but he became a mighty man of God. A mighty warrior, woman or man, doesn't matter whether you're male or female, you can be a mighty warrior for Jesus Christ. So we're going to talk a little bit about Gideon. Now I'm going to kind of skip through it because it's like three chapters long and we're not going to read it all. But basically, we're going to read Judges 6, 11 through 18, track with me. A lot of what I'm talking about is mainly reading, and so it will be on the screen. What you have to understand before this first section, the whole entire chapter before, they are being attacked. The Midianites just want to come in and they want to destroy Israel. They want to destroy God's people. And then there's Gideon, the little man, spazzing in the bathtub. Let's read about Gideon. Judges 6, 11 through 18. Now the angel of the Lord came and sat under the, and just ahead of time, I will murder some of these words. So, Taberinth at Ophrah. I'm guessing on some of this stuff, you guys. I do not have a master's degree in speaking Hebrew, okay? Or, you know, those names. Which belonged to Joash the Abiezerite, while his son Gideon was beating out wheat in the wine press to hide it from the Midianites. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him and said to him, The Lord is with you, O mighty man of valor. And Gideon said to him, please, my Lord, if the Lord is with me, why then has all this happened to us? And where are all his wonderful deeds that our fathers recounted to us, saying, did not the Lord bring us up out of Egypt? Sorry, I'm doing some of my own speak, okay? Now the Lord has forsaken us and given us into the hand of Midian. And the Lord turned to him and said, go in this might of yours and save Israel from the hand of Midian. Do not I send you? And he said to him, please, Lord, how can I save Israel? Behold, my clan is the weakest in Manasseh, and I am the least in my father's house. And the Lord said to him, but I will be with you, and you shall strike the Midianites as one man. And he said to him, if now I have found favor in your eyes, then show me a sign that it is you who speak with me. Please do not depart from here until I come to you and bring out my present and set it before you. And he said, I will stay till you return. So basically moving along, so we're not having to read through it all, Gideon basically goes and he gets a sacrifice. And back then, that's how they did it. They would do it. They would just do some kind of animal sacrifice as an offering to the Lord for their sin or whatever else. So he goes and he does a sacrifice, and he sacrifices before the angel, and he does this, and he prepares a meal for the angel, and all this is happening. Then, when the angel comes back and he does all that, then, after he's prepared the meal and he's done that, he goes back, and he decides to get holy boldness. He's like, okay, I'm a mighty man of valor. I can do this. I can do this. I can do this. So he goes to the high places, to the Midianites, his high places where all the idols were that they worshiped. And he tore them all down, and he busted them to pieces, and he made a big old wreck of their whole little worship temple thing they had. So he goes and does that, and you can guess what happened. The devil was mad. The Midianites were angry with Gideon. They were angry with the Israelites. They were angry with God's people. How dare you come and do that? So basically, the Midianites came and encamped all around where the Israelites were and surrounded them, basically, and made like this big camp around them. So now, moving on, I'm not going to read through these verses. We do have more verses to go through, but it's a lot, so I'm trying to just kind of skip through for you. So as we know, he's facing a physical army, but we face demons and the demonic realm that we can't see with our eyes. It affects us, but we can't see it. It attacks us with sickness, death, disease, job loss, money problems, whatever. Not that we don't ever make mistakes, but the devil is out to bring harm to us. That's what he does. So now Gideon, moving along further down into the chapter, he asked God, give me a sign. So Gideon asked God to give him a sign. And Gideon says, I have this fleece, which is like a cotton sheet of, you know, some kind of material. He says, I'm going to throw it out there. And he does this several times. Basically, he says, I'm going to throw it out there. And if I wake up and the ground around it is dry, but the fleece is covered with dew and wet, then I will know that you are truly an angel sent by God, and you're telling me to be a mighty man of valor. And then I'll think about it. So God proves it. He wakes up. The ground is dry. The fleece is wet. So then he knows. So this is what happens. Judges 7, 1 through 7. Then Jerubbaal, that is Gideon, and all the people who were with him rose early and encamped beside the spring of Harod. And the camp of Midian was north of them by the hill of Moreh in the valley. The Lord said to Gideon, the people with you are too many for me to give the Midianites into their hand, lest Israel boast over me, saying, my hand has saved me. Ever felt like that? He's telling Gideon to fight with less. Less. Now, therefore, proclaim in the ears of the people, saying, whoever is fearful and trembling, let him return home and hurry away from Mount Gilead. Then 22,000 of the people returned, and 10,000 remained. And the Lord said to Gideon, the people are still too many. Take them down to the water, and I will test them for you there. And anyone whom I say to you, this one shall not go with you, shall go with you, and this one who shall not go with you, okay? So he brought the people down to the water, and the Lord said to Gideon, everyone who laps the water with his tongue as a dog laps, you shall set by himself. Likewise, everyone who kneels down to drink, and the number of those who lapped, put their hands to their mouths, was 300 men. But all the rest of the people knelt down to drink their water. And the Lord said to Gideon, with the 300 men who lapped, I will save you and give the Midianites into your hand, and let all the others go, every man to his home. So here, this huge, vast army, and then it's Gideon and 300 men. God is taking away his weapons and his resources. Ever felt that way? Ever felt like he is letting you dry up? Because here, this is a whole nother sermon. But guess what happens when he does that? You have to lean into him. He's pulling you closer to him. He's saying, come on over here, little child, lean into me. And so sometimes he's doing that. But in this case, he wanted to prove that he was the true God. And he was the God of his people, the Israelites. And he was going to make sure that Gideon won with very little resources. So you got to understand, Gideon's still scared here. So this is really looking bad for Gideon. I'm sure he was reconsidering the whole thing. I'm sure he was becoming quite the spazzed cat. And he probably thought, okay, you proved to me with the fleece. Okay, you did send an angel. Okay, that's all real. But now I'm not so sure about this because I don't think I can fight this entire Midian army with 300 men that lap like dogs their water. Think about that. Would you guys choose the men that drink like dogs? You know, we would choose the men with manners. I'm just saying. And he's like, really, Lord? You know that's what he's thinking. You can't tell me that. So he must have been thinking that. So the verses continue, and he's shivering in his boots, and he's going, I don't know if I can submit to this, God. Yeah, you proved it. You sent an angel, and it's all real, but I don't think I can do this. I'm reconsidering. Let's just back up. Let's rethink this whole thing. Maybe we can just all run away. There's only 300 of us, you know. We'll just run while they're all asleep. So this is what happens. Further on down, verses 13 through 18. This is where God really lets Gideon see it's okay to submit to him. When Gideon came, behold, a man was telling a dream to his comrade. And he overheard this conversation, basically. And he said, behold, I dreamed a dream. And behold, a cake of barley bread tumbled into the camp of Midian and came to the tent and struck it so that it fell and turned it upside down so that the tent lay flat. And his comrade answered, this is no other than the sword of Gideon and the son of Joash, a man of Israel. God has given into his hand Midian and all the camp. As soon as Gideon heard the telling of the dream and its interpretation, he worshiped. And he returned to the camp of Israel and he said, arise, for the Lord has given the host of Midian into your hand. And he divided the 300 men into three companies and put trumpets in their hands, all of them, and empty jars with torches inside the jars. And he said to them, look at me and do likewise. When I come to the outskirts of the camp, do as I do. When I blow the trumpet, I and all who are with me then blow the trumpets, also on every side of all the camp, and shout for the Lord and for Gideon. So here, this is his, he rises up and he's like, I can do this. I can do this. I can submit to God. I can trust him. They had a dream. There's more proof. This is going to happen. God's called me to do this. I'm not a mighty man of valor, but I can do this. Because you know he's still thinking that. Who am I? I'm just Gideon. So moving along, and so I didn't have to read through everything for you. Moving along, what do you think happens? Some of you know the story. Don't cheat. Don't throw out answers. Here's the thing. Here's what happened. They went and surrounded the camp in the middle of the night. This was the way that they beat this entire army, okay? Literally, think about this. They all had a trumpet and a torch, a jar with a torch in it, a glass jar, or whatever the jars were made out of, probably clay. And so they surrounded them. Everybody shouted with the trumpets to cause a bunch of ruckus. And then they smashed the jars. And they made a big loud scene. The enemy was so confused by what was going on, they jumped up and killed each other. Literally. They woke up in such a startle, like, what is going on? That they literally turned on each other because it was pitch black out and they had no idea what was going on, and they began to stab each other with their swords. The entire army died. Pots and trumpets. How did you win that war? Well, you see, I had this pot. And I blew a trumpet and I broke the pot and everybody killed themselves. That doesn't sound logical, but here's the thing. And I preached on this, I think, like a year and a half ago, of who is your Midian army. But today, I'm saying to you, even if you think all you have is a jar and a trumpet, maybe you don't even have a jar. Maybe you only have a trumpet. Maybe all you have is, thank you, God. I trust you. Maybe you don't even have anything else. And you're thinking, how can I submit to God? How can I follow his will? How can I do this? I cannot trust. I can't do this. I'm a cat and I'm spazzing out in a cold bath. It don't even have to be cold and they're spazzing out. Yes. Pastor Matt, will you come up? You guys go ahead and stand. Stretch, enjoy. Here's the thing. Gideon was afraid, but ultimately he trusted God and he submitted. Ultimately, he trusted God and relaxed. So when you see that word, when someone says to you, submit to God. Defeat the devil. Don't take that word and think, I don't submit to anybody, blah, blah, blah. No. Transfer that word to relax. Relax in God, and you defeat the devil. Relax and trust him. You defeat the devil. Relax. Don't think you need to figure it out. Don't try to figure everything out tomorrow. He will take you one day at a time. Trust him. No matter what you're facing, whatever you've stepped out in faith for, trust him one day at a time. Don't let the spirit of cat attach to you. Some of y'all need to be delivered of the spirit of cat. You have to trust what God has for you. He doesn't say it won't take work and it won't be hard sometimes. And there won't be days that you get up and go, I don't know. I don't think I can do this. I don't think I can walk this out. Yes, you can. You can walk it out. Look at this room full of people. You know how many people in here? We know what it is to have to walk it out. We're still doing it every day. But if you will take this, this is going to help you stay dressed. So you're dressed for battle. Last week we anointed you. You feel like your only weapons you have are love and unity and the fear of the Lord. And maybe you're saying you feel like you're fighting with nothing. But you need to know you're not fighting with nothing. The key to staying dressed is submitting to God. You defeat the devil. That's the simplest way to say it. The devil, it's not even just about him fleeing from you. He just has no power over you. Anyone feel like you have a devil in your home? Anyone live with family? Okay. I always got to make that joke because some of y'all live together, and I know that it ain't easy to live with family, okay? So sometimes you want to tell the family member, I rebuke you. Sorry. Here's the thing. Submit to God. Relax in Him. You will defeat the enemy every day, all day long. You will kick him in the face. But you have to relax. Don't let the spirit of cat take over your life. Don't live your life like God is a cold bath. He's just torturing me. Here I go, I gotta trust again. No. Relax. God is a warm bath. And He welcomes you to come in and submit. Come under Him and let Him be your God. And you have to choose it every day. Choose it every day. Relax in God, submit and trust Him. So Pastor Matt's gonna, we're gonna go through Waymaker again, but I'm gonna be bold and I'm gonna say this to you. If you are here, because God is asking you, will you be a Gideon? Will you relax in Him and defeat the enemy in your life? Will you trust God enough? Will you submit to that? Will you relax? And if you say, I will, I'm not laying hands on anyone today. I'm not praying for anyone necessarily. But I'm going to invite you. Come on up, not to kneel, but come and worship at the altars. Come and stand and say, I will be a Gideon. And I declare that I will be a Gideon. I will no longer be a spastic cat. I will be a Gideon. Come up here and stand. If you say, I will be a Gideon, come up here. And as Matt leads us in worship, you're just going to be declaring, I am a Gideon. I will be a Gideon. I will be a Gideon. This is your declaration. Just come up and worship and say, I will be a Gideon.
I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. And you are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. And you are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. And you are Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. That That is who you are. 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 You are here, touching every heart. I worship you. I worship you.
Lift him high.
I worship you. I worship you. And you are here, mending every heart. I worship you. I worship you. And you are here. Yes, my God, that is who you are. Sing it out. That is who you are. 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 Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I can't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, lift your hands and sing it out. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I can't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I can't believe it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. And you are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. 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 That is who you are.
Hallelujah. We thank you, Lord. So I'm going to have all of you guys that... You know you've been struggling. You've been having the spirit of Cat. We're going to make a declaration this morning. You guys ready? I'm going to have you repeat after me. Say, I declare I will be a Gideon. I declare I will relax and trust God. I declare greater is he that is in me that is in this world. I declare that as I relax and submit, the devil will flee. In Jesus' name, amen. You guys are awesome. Let me go ahead and pray and bless you. Dear Heavenly Father, I bless every person in this room. Lord, I pray that as they leave this place, that your glory and your presence would go with them, Lord, that they would know it is okay to submit to you. It is okay to relax and trust you with their future. They don't need to freak out anymore, Lord. And that when they relax in you and they trust you, demons will flee and the devil will have no hold over their life or their home. And I just speak life and blessing over every family here. In Jesus' name, amen. You guys are awesome. Have an awesome afternoon. Please come back for the leaders training. If you did not sign up, you do not have to sign up necessarily. If you are not currently a volunteer, but you're interested in being a volunteer and hearing about the vision for 2020, just plan to come and have dinner and hang out and with the rest of the leaders. Have an awesome Sunday, guys.